Hello guys, this is Indian Medico and in this video we'll see a review of pediatrics. In this video we'll take a pediatric condition and see all the high yield points about that condition. That is, we'll first see a summary of that condition, then we'll see a clinical image of that condition, and for important clinical conditions we'll see a clinical case. First let us discuss about genetic defects. Down syndrome, it is the most common chromosomal abnormality. It is due to trisomy 21. This picture shows a case of Down syndrome. Note the flat face, epicanthal folds and wide set eyes. It is associated with endocardial quotient defects, duodenal atresia, Hirschsprung disease, hypothyroidism, mental retardation, leukemia and Alzheimer-like disease. Now let us see a case of Down syndrome. 1 week old infant in NICU found to have low set ears, flat occiput, simian crease, small mouth and protruding tongue. There is a holosystolic murmur on physical examination. This holosystolic murmur can be due to ventricular septal defect seen in Down syndrome. Now let us see about Edwards syndrome. It is due to trisomy 18. There will be rocker bottom feet and micrognathia or small jaw. This picture shows small jaw, shield chest, prominent occiput, malformed ears, clenched hands, flexed big toe and prominent heels. Now let us see about Patau syndrome. It is due to trisomy 13. The features include microophthalmia, holoprosencephaly, which is failure of development of forebrain, polydactyly, microcephaly and cleft lip or cleft palate. This picture shows a case of Patau syndrome. Now let us see about Turner syndrome. The karyotype is 45XO, basically female with a missing X chromosome. The clinical features include lymphedema of the hands and feet, shield shaped chest, white spaced nipples, webbed neck and low hairline. This picture shows a case of Turner syndrome. Note the webbed neck and shield shaped chest. It is associated with coarctation of the aorta, bicuspid aortic wall and aortic stenosis. There will be gonadal dysgenesis in 100% of cases of Turner syndrome. Now let us see about the treatment of Turner syndrome. Growth hormone should be given for short stature and estrogen and progesterone should be given for secondary sexual development. Now let us see a case of Turner syndrome. 15-year-old presents with primary amenorrhea. Physical examination reveals widely spaced nipples, webbed neck and a crescendo-decrescendo systolic murmur at the right upper sternal border. This crescendo-decrescendo systolic murmur can be due to aortic stenosis. Now let us see about Klinefelter syndrome. The karyotype is 47XXY, that is a male with an extra X. It is the most common cause of hypogonadism in males. The clinical features include small phallus or penis, small testis leading to hypospermia, gynecomastia, increased height and learning disability with normal IQ. This picture shows a male with Klinefelter syndrome. Notice the gynecomastia and tall height. There will be bar body, which is due to inactivated X chromosome. Now let us see about the treatment of Klinefelter syndrome. Testosterone is given to improve secondary sexual characteristics and prevent gynecomastia. Now let us see a case of Klinefelter syndrome. 14-year-old male presents with gynecomastia. Physical examination reveals a tall male with small phallus and small testis. Now let us see about Prader-Willi syndrome. It is characterized by uncontrollable appetite and Pickwickian syndrome. Pickwickian syndrome is obesity hypoventilation syndrome. This picture shows a case of Prader-Willi syndrome. The mode of inheritance is paternal imprinting. That is, paternally inherited allele is silenced and maternally inherited allele is active. Now let us see about Angelman syndrome. It is also known as happy puppet syndrome. It is characterized by ataxic gait and tiptoe walk. there will be severe mental retardation and episodes of uncontrollable laughter, as you can see in this picture. The mode of inheritance is maternal imprinting, that is, allele of a particular gene inherited from the mother is transcriptionally silent and paternally inherited allele is active. Now let us see about Fragile X syndrome. It is due to trinucleotide repeats. There will be severe mental retardation. This picture shows a case of Fragile X syndrome. Now let us discuss about congenital heart diseases. First, let us discuss cyanotic heart diseases. The various cyanotic heart lesions can be remembered by the mnemonic 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One is truncus arteriosus. In this case, one arterial vessel overrides ventricles. Two is transposition of the great vessels. In this case, two arteries are switched. Three is tricuspid atresia. Four is tetralogy of Fallot. Five is total anomalous pulmonary venous return. It has five words. Now let us see about transposition of the great vessels. It is the most common cyanotic lesion presenting in the first 2 weeks of life. Two arteries are switched. This picture shows a normal heart. The aorta arises from the left ventricle and the pulmonary artery arises from the right ventricle. In case of transposition of great vessels, this is switched. That is, aorta arises from the right ventricle and pulmonary artery arises from the left ventricle. Cardiomegaly and egg-shaped solute are the chest X-ray findings. This picture shows egg-shaped solute seen in chest X-ray in transposition of great vessels. Also, in many cases of transposition of great vessels, there are connecting vessels like patent ductus arteriosus and atrial septal defect. How do you treat a case of transposition of the great vessels? We have to do arterial switch in the first 2 weeks of life. Left ventricle will decompensate if procedure is delayed beyond 2 weeks. Now let us see a case of transposition of the great vessels. Cyanotic newborn presents with respiratory distress, right ventricular heave and a loud S2. Chest X-ray reveals cardiomegaly and an egg-shaped solute. Now let us see about tetralogy of Fallot. A mnemonic to remember the features is prove there will be pulmonic stenosis, right ventricular hypertrophy, overriding aorta and ventricular septal defect. This picture shows a normal heart. In this picture shows a heart with tetralogy of Fallot. Note the pulmonic stenosis, right ventricular hypertrophy, overriding aorta and ventricular septal defect. It is characterized by periods of increased right flow obstruction that causes cyanosis by increasing right to left shunt. This is known as dead spells. Chest X-ray shows boot-shaped heart and decreased pulmonary vascular markings. As you can see in this picture, there is boot-shaped heart along with decreased pulmonary vascular markings. Now let us see a clinical case of tetralogy of Fallot. 2-month-old infant presents with respiratory distress and episodic periods of cyanosis or dead spells due to right to left shunt. Physical examination reveals right ventricular heave and a loud systolic ejection murmur due to pulmonary stenosis. Chest X-ray shows boot-shaped heart. Now let us see about total or partial anomalous pulmonary venous return. In this case, there is venous blood returning to the right atrium. Now let us see a clinical picture of total anomalous pulmonary venous return. As you can see, the pulmonary veins do not connect to the left atrium. There is different connection of pulmonary veins to the heart. Now let us see about Epstein anomaly. It is tricuspid wall displacement into the right ventricle. It occurs due to maternally ingested lithium. This picture shows a normal heart. This picture shows a heart with Epstein anomaly. As you can see, there is abnormal tricuspid wall into the right ventricle. So there will be a small right ventricle. Now let us see about acinetic heart lesions. The various acinetic heart lesions are ventricular septal defect, atrial septal defect and patent ductus arteriosus. Now let us see about ventricular septal defect. It is the most common congenital heart defect. This picture shows ventricular septal defect. There will be left to right shunt. As the disease progresses, there will be increase in pulmonary resistance leading to right to left shunt. This is known as Eisenmenger syndrome, which is a complication of large untreated ventricular septal defect. Deficiency of endocardial cushion can lead to atrioventricular canal defects like ostium primum atrial septal defect and inlet ventricular septal defect. Now let us see a case of ventricular septal defect. 1 month old infant with no significant medical history is found to have a grade 3 harsh holosystolic murmur heard best at the left lower sternal border on routine examination. Now let us see about patent ductus arteriosus. It is associated with rubella. A mnemonic is PDA ends with A and rubella also ends with A. Now let us see a clinical case of rubella with the patent ductus arteriosus. Newborn infant presents with tachypnea and poor feeding tolerance. Continuous machine-like murmur is heard on physical examination. This picture shows patent ductus arteriosus. There is a communication between aorta and pulmonary artery. Now let us see about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. The mode of inheritance is autosomal dominant. Clinical features include chest pain, dyspnea on exertion, and syncope. It is a common cause of sudden cardiac death in athletes. This picture shows a normal heart. This picture shows enlargement of heart muscle of left ventricle in case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Now let us see a clinical case. 15-year-old athlete experiences sudden cardiac death during a basketball game. Pathologic exam reveals a muscular intraventricular septum and a significant left ventricular hypertrophy. This is a classical case of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Now let us discuss about heart blocks. First, let us discuss about first degree heart block. In this case, there is prolonged PR interval with a regular rhythm. As you can see in this picture, the PR interval is prolonged, that is, it is greater than 200 milliseconds, but the rhythm is regular. Now let us see about second degree heart block type 1 or Wenckebach or Mobitz type 1 heart block. In this case, there is progressive prolongation of PR interval until a QRS complex is missed. This picture shows progressive prolongation of PR interval. As you can see, the PR interval progressively prolongs until the QRS complex is dropped. Now let us see about second degree heart block type 2 or Mobitz type 2. In this case, there is sudden disruption in AV conduction with no progressive prolongation of the PR interval. As you can see in this picture, there is a non-connected P wave and a dropped QRS complex and fixed PR interval. This is a case of Mobitz type 2. Now let us see about third degree heart block. In this case, there is complete AV dissociation. As you can see in this picture, the P waves march through the QRS complexes. Also, there are regular PP intervals which are unrelated to regular RR intervals, indicating complete AV dissociation. Now let us see about sinus tachycardia. As the name sinus indicates, it originates in SA node. The heart rate is greater than 100. It is usually around 150 beats per minute. The rhythm is regular. The P waves are similar. Sometimes the P waves may be tall and peaked, and sometimes they are partially hidden. The PR interval and QRS complex will be normal. Causes of sinus tachycardia include fever, dehydration, exercise, and anemia. Now let us see about Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. In this case, delta waves are seen due to pre-excitation of the ventricle via an accessory pathway. This picture shows a normal heart with a normal electrical pathway. In case of Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome, there are accessory pathways causing delta waves, as you can see in this picture. In Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome, digoxin is contraindicated. This is because digoxin slows the AV node. By doing this, an accessory pathway can depolarize and potentially create a re-entrant circuit. Now let us see a case of Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. 12-year-old presents with symptomatic episodic palpitations during exercise. ECG reveals delta waves. Now let us see about pediatric development milestones. The important age to remember in pediatric development milestones are 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, 18 months, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years and 5 years. Now let us see about gross motor milestones. Neck holding at 3 months. In gross motor, you have to remember 3 in addition to the above mentioned year, age. One is 5 months, the other is 8 months, and the other is 15 months. There will be rolling over in 5 months. The child sits with support 6 months, sits without support at 8 months, stands with support at 9 months, stands without support at 12 months. At 15 months, the child walks, then he runs, then he climbs stairs 2 feet per step, then he rides tricycle, then he climbs stairs 1 feet per step. Coming to fine motor, it starts at 4 months and not 3 months. Then there will be unidextrous reach at 6 months. Then there will be immature pincer grasp, mature pincer grasp, tower of 3 blocks, tower of 6 blocks, tower of 9 blocks, Coppi's triangle, Coppi's cross and Coppi's triangle. Now let us see about social milestones. It starts at 2 months. At 2 months there will be social smile. Then he recognizes mother. Then there will be stranger anxiety. He waves bye bye. Comes when called. Coppi's parents in tasks. Asks for food. Knows full name and gender. Goes to toilet alone. Dresses and undresses. Coming to language milestones, it starts at 1 month. At 1 month, the baby will be alert to sound. Then he coos. Then he speaks monosyllables, bisyllables, 1 to 2 words, 8 to 10 words, sentences, knows full name and gender, tells stories, asks meaning of words. The birth weight should triple by 1 year. Vitamin D supplementation is necessary for exclusively breastfed infant. Now let us see about the sequence of events in female puberty. Telarch is breast development. It is followed by pubarch, which is development of pubic hair. Then there will be growth spurt and menarch, which is first menstrual period. Now let us see about the sequence of events in male puberty. There will be testicular enlargement, then pubarch, then penile enlargement, and then growth spurt. Let us see about the tanner stages of development in female. Coming to breast development, mnemonic is nobody elevates two mountains in adulthood. In stage 1, there will be no glandular tissue. In stage 2, there will be breast bud. In stage 3, the breast bud will be elevated. Stage 4, there will be secondary mound. And stage 5 is final adult size. Coming to pubic hair development, the mnemonic is not a small cat. In stage 1, there will be no hair. Stage 2, there will be small amount of hair. Stage 3, there will be coarse and curly hair. Stage 5 is adult like hair. And stage 6 is involvement of thighs. And let us see about tanner staging in males. Stage 1 is prepubertal. The testicular size is less than 4 cc in volume. In stage 2, there is enlargement of scrotum and testis. The testis will be greater than or equal to 4 cc in volume. Stage 3, there is enlargement of penis. Stage 4, there is increased size of penis with development of glands. The testes and scrotum become larger and the scrotal skin becomes darker. Stage 5 is adult genitalia. Now let us see clinical cases. Breast bud development and enlargement of areola diameter is Tanner stage 2 in females. Increased darkening of scrotal skin is Tanner stage 4 in males. Now let us see about vaccination. First let us discuss national immunization schedule. At birth we give BCG, OPV 0 dose and hepatitis B bird dose. At 6 weeks we give OPV 1, pentavalent 1, which contains DPT, hepatitis B and Haemophilus influenza B. Then we give rotavirus vaccine 1 in Andhra Pradesh, Assam, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, Tripura and Uttar Pradesh. Fraction dose of inactivated polio, that is FIPV1, is given. Pneumococcal conjugate vaccine PCV1 is given in the following states: Bihar, Himachal Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, 12 districts of Uttar Pradesh and 9 districts of Rajasthan. At 6 weeks we give OPV2, pentavalent 2 and rotavirus vaccine 2. At 14 weeks we give OPV3, pentavalent 3, IPV2, rotavirus vaccine 3 and pneumococcal vaccine 2. At 9 to 12 months, we give measles and rubella, that is MR1, JE1 in 231 endemic districts and PCV booster. between 16 to 24 months, we give MR2, GA2, DBT booster and OPV booster. Between 5 to 6 years, we give DBT booster 2. At 10 years, we give TT or TD, that is tetanus and adult diphtheria. At 16 years, again we give TT or TD. For pregnant mothers, we have to give 2 doses of TT or TD. Now let us discuss some points regarding various vaccines. OPV is the number one cause of polio in developed countries, so these countries give IPV. Varicella vaccination should be given only for children above 12 months of age. MMR, varicella and OPV are contraindicated in immunocompromised patients because these are live vaccines. MMR and influenza contain egg protein, so they should be used cautiously in patients with egg allergy. Pneumococcal, meningococcal and HIV vaccines are used against encapsulated organisms. They are conjugated vaccines. What are conjugated vaccines? Conjugated vaccines combine a weak antigen with a strong antigen as a carrier so that the immune system has a stronger response to the weak antigen. These vaccines are required in asplenic patients because these patients are prone for sepsis by encapsulated organisms. DTP is contraindicated in patients with progressive neurologic disorders or encephalopathy within 7 days of administration. The pertussis component is associated with seizures. Now let us see about failure to thrive. It is a condition in which a child's weight or height is less than the third percentile for age or has fallen across two major percentiles. This picture shows a weight for age growth chart recommended by WHO. If the weight of the child is here, it indicates failure to thrive. Also, if the growth curve of the child is like this, it indicates failure to thrive. Now let us see about the risk factors for failure to thrive. Low socioeconomic status, low maternal age, low birth weight, caregiver neglect and pathological diseases. Now let us see about the common organic causes of failure to thrive. Congenital heart disease, cystic fibrosis, celiac disease, pyloric stenosis, infection and gastroesophageal reflux. Now let us see about immunodeficiency syndromes. First let us see about T cell immunodeficiencies. They present at 1 to 3 months. They present with broad range of infections like fungal, bacterial or viral infections. The most common T cell deficiency syndrome is Dijon syndrome and ataxia telangiectasia. Now let us see about Dijon syndrome. In this case, there is agenesis of 3rd and 4th pharyngeal pouch, which are responsible for development of thymus and parathyroid gland. The clinical manifestations of Dijon syndrome can be remembered by the mnemonic CATCH-22. There is cardiac anomalies like tetralogy of Fallot, interrupted aortic arch and vascular rings. There is abnormal phases, as you can see in this picture. There is thymic hypoplasia, cleft palate, hypocalcemia due to non-development of parathyroid gland. It is due to chromosome 22q11 microdeletion. Now let us see about ataxia telangiectasia. There is cerebellar ataxia, oculocutaneous telangiectasia, as you can see in this picture. This one shows ocular telangiectasia and these pictures are cutaneous telangiectasias. There is decreased T cell function and low antibody levels. Since there are low antibody levels, ataxia telangiectasia is considered to be combined immunodeficiency in some textbooks. Now let us see about B cell deficiency syndromes. They present at 6 months. This is because maternal antibodies protect infant up to this age. Remember, T cell deficiency syndromes present between 1 to 3 months. They present with recurrent upper respiratory tract infections and bacteremia caused by encapsulated organisms. The most common B cell deficiency syndromes include X-linked A-gamma globulinemia, common variable immunodeficiency and selective IgA deficiency. X-linked A-gamma globulinemia is also known as Bruton A-gamma globulinemia. In this case, there is total lack of antibody production. In selective IgA deficiency, there is recurrent respiratory, gastrointestinal and urinary tract infections. Now let us see about combined B and T cell immunodeficiency syndromes. These include severe combined immunodeficiency disease or SCID, and Wishcott-Aldrich syndrome. For SEID, bone marrow transplantation is curative. The clinical features of Wishcott-Aldrich syndrome can be removed with pneumonic water. W is decreased IgM. If you invert W, it becomes M. So there is decreased IgM, elevated IgA, thrombocytopenia, eczema, and recurrent infections. This picture shows eczematous lesions of Wishcott-Aldrich syndrome with purpura and petechiae due to thrombocytopenia. Now let us see about phagocytic immunodeficiency syndromes. These include chronic granulomatous disease and Shediak-Higashi syndrome. These cases present with poor wound healing, abscess formation, and granulomas. Now let us see about chronic granulomatous disease. The pattern of inheritance is X-linked recessive. There is lack of oxidative burst that produces hydrogen peroxide needed for phagocytosis. Shediak-Higashi syndrome is an autosomal recessive disorder. In this case, there is defect in neutrophil chemostasis necessary for phagocytosis. There are oculocutaneous manifestations like albinism. This picture shows a case of Shediak-Higashi syndrome. As you can see, there is albinism. Now let us see about child abuse. The clinical features include ecchymosis of varying age and pattern injuries. These include cigarette burns, iron rod burns, immersion burns, which is caused due to immersing a child in boiling water, and belt markings. Ocular examination reveals retinal hemorrhages, which is due to violent shaking or shaken baby syndrome. X-rays will show spiral fractures. Genitourinary examination may reveal sexually transmitted diseases and genital trauma. Head CT scan will show subdural hemorrhage, which is due to vigorous shaking called as shaken baby syndrome. Now let us see a case of child abuse. 4-year-old presents with arm pain following trauma. History as per the mother is inconsistent with injury. X-ray reveals a spiral fracture. This picture shows spiral fracture. This is X-ray of spiral fracture. This picture shows avulsion fracture, which is caused due to sudden jerk. This X-ray shows avulsion fracture. In children, the bridging cerebral veins are poorly supported as they pass through the subdural space. So, violent shaking may cause subdural hematoma. This picture shows subdural hematoma. This picture shows retinal hemorrhages. These are the pictures of child abuse. Now let us see about cerebral palsy. It is non-progressive, non-hereditary disorder of movement and posture. The risk factors include prematurity, mental retardation in 50% of cases, low birth weight, fetal malformation, neonatal seizures, neonatal cerebral hemorrhage, and perinatal asphyxia. The most frequent presenting sign is delayed motor development, which is often missed until the child fails to meet developmental milestones. The most common form of cerebral palsy is pyramidal cerebral palsy. It is characterized by spasticity in all affected limbs. This picture shows a child with cerebral palsy. Now let us see about the treatment of cerebral palsy. Benzodiazepines, dantrolene, and baclofen. The goal is to reduce spasticity. Now let us see about febrile seizures. It is non-epileptic seizure in children between 6 months to 5 years of age, associated with fevers. The rapidity of fever onset, not the absolute temperature, is the determining factor. Now let us see the differences between simple and complex febrile seizures. Simple febrile seizure usually lasts for less than 15 minutes. Complex febrile seizures last for more than 15 minutes. In simple febrile seizure, there will be only one seizure in a 24-hour period. In complex febrile seizure, there will be more than one seizure in a 24-hour period. Simple febrile seizure is usually generalized seizure. Complex febrile seizure is usually a focal seizure. No investigations are needed for simple febrile seizure. Complex febrile seizure require lumbar puncture, laboratory studies, electroencephalogram, and CTR MRI. Simple febrile seizure is associated with a 2% risk of epilepsy. The risk in general population without febrile seizure is 1%. So, simple febrile seizure increases the risk of epilepsy by 2 times. Now, let us see a case of simple febrile seizure. 3-year-old presents with one generalized seizure lasting 1 minute. No significant past history. Physical examination reveals fevers but is otherwise normal. Now, let us discuss various conditions in neonatology. First, let us discuss about Apgar score. A mnemonic to remember Apgar score is the name Apgar. A stands for appearance. The scores are 0, 1, 2. Blue is 0. When the body is pink and the extremities are blue, it is 1. And when the baby is completely pink, it is 2. Regarding pulse rate, 0 is absent pulse, 1 is less than 100 beats per minute, and 2 is greater than 100 beats per minute. Regarding grimace or reflex irritability, 0 is no response, 1 is grimace, and 2 is cough or sneeze. A is activity or muscle tone, 0 is limp, 1 is some flexion, and 2 is active movements. R is respiration, score 0 when there are no respiration, there is absent respiration. Score is 1 when there is weak cry, and score is 2 when there is strong cry. Now let us see clinical examples. A newborn with pink trunk, heart rate of 50, a grimace and cough when stimulated, strong muscle tone, and an irregular respiratory effort. So if you add all these, it will come to 7. If the Apgar score is greater than or equal to 7, only routine care is necessary, that is, no resuscitation is needed. Now let us see the next case. A blue newborn with a heart rate of 30, grimace when stimulated, appears limp and has no respiratory effort. In this case, it is 1 plus 1, 2. So when the Apgar score is less than or equal to 3, the baby requires full resuscitation. When the Apgar score is between 4 to 6, some resuscitation like suctioning and oxygen is needed. Now let us see about congenital infections. We will be discussing clinical cases. A 3-week-old infant found to have leukochoria, that is, absent red reflex, a continuous mission-like murmur, blueberry muffin skin, and salt and pepper retinitis. This is a case of congenital rubella infection. Another case, a 16-month-old infant found to have sensory neural hearing loss. This is also rubella. A mnemonic to remember, rubella associated with PDA is rubella ends with A, PDA also ends with A. A mnemonic to remember, sensory neural hearing loss associated with rubella is rubella as bell, the child won't be able to hear. Okay, now let us see the various manifestations of congenital rubella syndrome. There will be microcephaly, patent ductus arteriosus, congenital cataracts, which are responsible for leukochoria or absent red reflex, skin manifestations, which are called as blueberry muffin skin, retinitis, which is called as salt and pepper retinitis. Now let us see another case. A 1-month-old male found to have periventricular calcifications, as you can see in this picture, hepatosplenomegaly, chorea retinitis, and a left inguinal hernia. This is a case of congenital cytomegalovirus infection. In congenital CMV infection, there will be periventricular calcifications, hepatosplenomegaly, and chorea retinitis. It is associated with an increased risk of inguinal hernia. Now, moving on to the next case, a 3-day-old male found to have skin vesicles and keratoconjunctivitis. This picture shows the vesicles in this case. This is a case of herpes simplex virus. In case of congenital herpes simplex infection, there will be skin vesicles and keratoconjunctivitis. Moving on to the next case, a 2-week-old female found to have osteochondritis, periosteitis, maculopapular rash, and snuffles. This is a case of congenital syphilis caused by treponema pallidum. Now let us see the various features of treponema pallidum. There will be osteochondritis and periosteitis. There will be a maculopapular rash. This picture shows Hutchinson T, that is, notched incisors seen in congenital syphilis infection. This picture shows syphilitic rhinitis, which is called as snuffles. Now let us see about the next case. A 1-week-old male found to have generalized calcifications on head MRI, as you can see in this picture, and chorea retinitis. This is a case of congenital toxoplasmosis caused by Toxoplasma gondii. In this case, there will be generalized calcifications and chorea retinitis. We have to do HIV DNA PCR to detect HIV status in an infant of a HIV positive mother. Now let us see about neonatal sepsis. The causes of neonatal sepsis can be remembered by the mnemonic GEL. G for group B streptococci, E for E. coli, and L for Listeria monocytogenes. and it is about the treatment of neonatal sepsis. Ampicillin and gentamicin should be given for 7 days. Now let us see about sepsis screen. It is used to detect sepsis. Sepsis is diagnosed when greater than or equal to 2 of these are present. Total leukocyte count less than 5000 cells per millimeter cube. Absolute neutrophil count less than 1800. Immature to total neutrophil ratio greater than 0.2. C-reactive protein greater than 1 mg per deciliter. Micro ESR greater than or equal to 15 mm in the first hour. If greater than or equal to 2 of these conditions are positive, we can diagnose neonatal sepsis. Now let us see about respiratory distress syndrome or RDS. It is the most common cause of respiratory failure in a premature newborn. The pathogenesis is lack of adequate surfactant production causing alveolar collapse. The infant presents with tachypnea, grunting, retractions and nasal flaring in the first few hours of life. Now let us see about the typical course of RDS. There will be progressive worsening and pending respiratory failure in the first 48 to 72 hours. Chest X-ray shows diffuse atelectasis and a groundless appearance, as you can see in this picture. It usually requires intubation and surfactant administration. Now let us see about the complications of treatment of RDS. Due to mechanical ventilation, there can be bronchopulmonary dysplasia, retinopathy of prematurity and barotrauma. Now let us see a case of respiratory distress syndrome. 1-day-old neonate who is a 30-week preterm presents with retractions, nasal flaring and cyanosis. Chest X-ray shows diffuse atelectasis. Now let us see about neonatal jaundice. Physiological jaundice is due to transient unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia caused by large bilirubin load that overwhelms a maturing liver system. That is, it is basically due to immature liver system. What are the features of pathologic jaundice? Hyperbilirubinemia in the first 24 hours, prolonged jaundice and conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. All these point towards pathologic jaundice. Now let us see about carnic teres. It is a fatal complication of neonatal hyperbilirubinemia. In this case, there is bilirubin staining of basal ganglia, pons and cerebellum. This picture shows a case of neonatal jaundice. Now let us see about the treatment of severe jaundice. The treatment options include phototherapy and exchange transfusion. Now let us see about necrotizing enterocolitis. In this case, a portion of bowel of the neonate dies. The radiographic findings include pneumatosis intestinalis, that is air in the intestine, as you can see in this picture. Now let us see about congenital anomalies. Now let us see how a case of tracheoesophageal fistula presents. Neonate with inability to feed, excessive salivation and recurrent aspiration pneumonia with a polyhydramniotic mother. This is a classical case of tracheoesophageal fistula. This picture shows the most common type of tracheoesophageal fistula. The esophagus ends in a blind pouch and there is distal tracheoesophageal fistula. Now let us see about duodenal atresia. It presents as a neonate with bilious emesis and a double bubble sign on abdominal radiograph. This picture shows the double bubble sign in abdominal x-ray indicating duodenal atresia. Now let us see a case of duodenal atresia. Newborn with history of trisomy. Down syndrome is a risk factor for duodenal atresia and in utero polyhydramnios. Presence with bilious emesis. Abdominal x-ray shows double bubble sign, that is there are two bubbles. Now a neonate born with abdominal viscera herniating through the umbilicus contained in a sac is a case of omphalocele. In case of gastric cases, there will be no sac. This picture shows omphalocele. As you can see, the abdominal viscera is herniating through the umbilicus and it is covered by a sac. In case of gastric cases, there is no sac. Omphalocele is associated with other congenital anomalies. As you can see in this picture, there is cleft lip and cleft palate. Now let us see, discuss about various infectious diseases. First, let us discuss about complications of group A streptococcal infections. The various complications include peritonsillar abscess, retropharyngeal abscess, rheumatic fever, and post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis cannot be avoided even with antibiotic treatment. The features include hematuria, oliguria, hypertension, and edema. Let us see what acute rheumatic fever. The clinical manifestations can be remembered by the mnemonic Jones. J stands for joints, that is, there will be migratory polyarthritis. O resembles heart, so there will be pancarditis. N for subcutaneous nodules, E for erythema marginatum, and S for syndrome chorea. These are the major criteria for diagnosing acute rheumatic fever. These are also known as Jones criteria. The determinant of morbidity in case of acute rheumatic fever is mitral and aortic wall stenosis or regurgitation. Now let us see about viral exanthems. In case of measles, there will be cough, coryza, and conjunctivitis along with maculopapular rash. This picture shows a case of measles. Now let us see about varicella. There will be fever with a vesicular rash at different stages. This picture shows the rash of varicella. Now let us see a case of varicella or chickenpox. 10-year-old presents with fever and a pruritic rash spreading from the trunk to the arms. Physical examination reveals vesicles of varying stage. Now let us see about roseola infantum. In this case, there will be maculopapular rash, as you can see in this picture. There will be associated febrile seizures, and it is caused by human herpes virus 6 infection. Now let us see about erythema infectiosum. It is called as fifth disease. There will be slapped cheek appearance, as you can see in this picture. It is caused by parvovirus B19 infection. Now let us see about hand, foot, and mouth disease. In this case, there will be painful ulcers on the tongue and oral mucosa, and a maculopapular rash on distal limbs and buttocks. This picture shows the ulcers on oral mucosa in case of hand, foot, and mouth disease. These ulcers will be painful. Now let us see a clinical case. 15-year-old presents with fevers and exudative pharyngitis. Physical examination reveals generalized lymphadenopathy. Blood smear reveals atypical lymphocytes, and neutrophil antibody test is positive. This is a case of mononucleosis caused by Epstein-Barr virus. This picture shows the pharyngitis in case of infectious mononucleosis. Now let us see about upper airway obstruction. The various differential diagnoses include foreign body aspiration, croup, epiglottitis, retropharyngeal abscess, bacterial tracheitis, and angioedema. Now let us see a case of foreign body aspiration. 2-year-old presents with sudden onset dyspnea and respiratory distress. Physical examination reveals decreased breath sounds on the right side. Now let us see about croup. The most common cause of croup is parainfluenza virus. Croup is also known as laryngotracheobronchitis. It presents with inspiratory stridor and barky cough. There will be steeple sign on AP neck films, as you can see in this picture. It responds to racemic epinephrine. Now let us see a case of croup. 4-year-old presents with barky cough, fever, and rhinorrhea. X-ray reveals steeple sign. Now let us see about epiglottitis. It presents with high fever, sniffing dog position, toxic appearance, and drooling. It is caused due to haemophilus influenza. It is very rare due to HIV vaccination. It requires emergent endotracheal intubation. This picture shows thumb sign seen in epiglottitis. This picture shows inflamed and infected epiglottis. This picture shows the same epiglottis after treatment with antibiotics. Now let us see about otitis media. The most common cause of otitis media in children are Streptococcus pneumonia, non-typhable haemophilus influenza, and Moraxella catarrhalis. On examination, there will be bulging tympanic membrane, as you can see in this picture. There will also be loss of tympanic membrane light reflex, decreased mobility of tympanic membrane on pneumatic otoscopy. Let us see about the treatment of otitis media. High dose amphicillin. The dose is 80 to 90 mg per kilogram per day for 10 days. Resistant organisms require amoxicillin, clavulanic acid, or augmentin. Now let us see a case of otitis media. 2-year-old presents with fevers and ear pulling. tympanic membrane is erythematous and bulging without a red reflex. Now let us see about bronchiolitis. The most common cause of bronchiolitis is respiratory syncytial virus. Bronchiolitis is basically inflammation and swelling of bronchioles, whereas bronchitis is inflammation and swelling of bronchi. In chest x-ray, you can find peribronchial thickening in case of bronchiolitis. Now let us see a case of bronchiolitis. 6-month-old presents with cough, rhinorrhea and fevers in December. Chest x-ray shows peribronchial thickening. Nasopharyngeal aspirate reveals RSV antigen. Now let us see about meningitis. First let us see a case. 8-year-old presents with fever, photophobia, stiff neck and headache. So the symptoms of meningitis are fever, photophobia, neck stiffness and headache. Physical examination reveals positive Kernicke and Purkinje sign. What is Kernicke sign? Kernicke sign is pain on extension of knee. Purkinje sign is flexion of hips and knees when neck is flexed. Okay, what investigation you will do for a case of meningitis? You will do lumbar puncture. In this case, it shows normal glucose and low white blood cells. So this is a case of viral meningitis. In case of bacterial meningitis, the glucose will be reduced and the white blood cells will be increased. Now let us see about the treatment of bacterial meningitis. In case of neonate, we can give ampicillin and cefotaxime. For older children, we have to give vancomycin and ceftriaxone. Now let us see about gastroenteritis. When it is caused by shigella, there will be neurologic symptoms of seizures, mental status changes and lethargy. When it is caused by salmonella, there will be sepsis and meningitis. Rotavirus is the most common non-bacterial agent causing gastroenteritis. The incidence of rotavirus gastroenteritis is now decreasing with vaccination. Yersinia gastroenteritis as a pseudo-appendicitis picture, that is, it mimics appendicitis. Hemolytic uremic syndrome is most commonly caused due to E. coli O157H7 strain. This is the cause in 90% of cases of hemolytic uremic syndrome. Now let us see a clinical case of viral gastroenteritis caused by rotavirus. 2-year-old presents with 2-day history of non-bloody, watery diarrhea and vomiting. Child attends daycare. Physical examination shows mild dehydration but is otherwise normal. Now let us see about various nephrologic conditions. Vesico-ureteral reflex. In this case, there will be recurrent urinary tract infections. Diagnosis is using voiding cystourethrogram. This picture shows vesico-ureteral reflex in voiding cystourethrogram. As you can see, there is retrograde flow of urine. Now let us see a clinical case of posterior urethral wall causing vesico-ureteral reflex. 3-year-old boy presents with recurrent urinary tract infections. VCUG reveals abnormally placed urethral insertion into the bladder. Now let us see about hypospadias. It is the most common penile congenital anomaly. In hypospadias, the opening of the urethra is located on the underside of the penis or near the scrotum. These are the possible sites of urethral opening in case of hypospadias. There will also be hooded foreskin. Now let us see about the complications of cryptarchidism, that is failure of descent of testis into the scrotum. Due to this, there will be impaired sperm production and increased risk of testicular malignancy. Now let us see about nephrotic syndrome. The characteristics of nephrotic syndrome include proteinuria, hypoalbuminemia, hyperlipidemia and edema. The most common cause of nephrotic syndrome is minimal change disease. Treatment of nephrotic syndrome is with steroids. It has the best prognosis. Now let us see a case of minimal change disease. 4-year-old presents with periorbital edema on routine exam. Urine analysis reveals severe proteinuria and lipid profile shows hyperlipidemia. Now let us see about glomerulonephritis. The hallmark of glomerulonephritis is hematuria. Now let us see about acute post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. It is the most common cause of glomerulonephritis. There will be hematuria, which will be preceded by pharyngitis 2 weeks prior. There will be elevated ASO titer and low complement C3 levels. Now let us see about rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. In this case, there will be hematuria with an insidious regression to renal failure and encephalopathy. Now let us see about hinoxandrine purpura. In this case, there will be palpable purpura on the lower limbs and buttocks, followed by abdominal pain and hematuria. This picture shows the palpable purpura in case of hinoxandrine purpura. Now let us see a case of hinoxandrine purpura. 8-year-old presents with painful purpura after jumping on a trampoline. Physical examination reveals palpable purpura on the legs and buttocks with mild abdominal discomfort on examination. In Alport syndrome, there is nephritic clinical picture accompanied by sensory neural hearing loss. Now let us see about various conditions in pediatric gastroenterology. First, let us see a classical case of appendicitis. A 13-year-old presents with fever, emesis, and diffuse periumbilical pain that has localized to the right lower quadrant. So what are the symptoms of appendicitis? Fever, vomiting, and diffuse periumbilical pain localizing to the right lower quadrant. On physical examination, there is guarding, tenderness, and positive psoas and obdurate signs. What is psoas sign? Psoas sign is pain on hip extension. Obdurate sign is pain on internal rotation of hip. It is also important to remember that appendicitis is the most common indication for surgical intervention in children. Now let us see about pyloric stenosis. It presents with projectile non-bilious vomiting in firstborn males 2 to 5 weeks of age. On examination, there will be olive-shaped mobile non-tender mass. It is diagnosed using ultrasound. The treatment is with surgical pylorotomy. This picture shows a case of pyloric stenosis. This picture shows pylorotomy and this is the after procedure picture. Now let us see a clinical case of pyloric stenosis. 1-month-old firstborn male presents with projectile non-bilious vomiting. Physical examination reveals a mobile non-tender olive-shaped mass in the epigastric area. Now let us see about intussusception. It is the most common cause of bowel obstruction in children less than 2 years of age. Intussusception arises from lead points like meckel diverticulum, intestinal lymphoma, hinoxandrine purpura, celiac disease, cystic fibrosis, and infection. This picture shows a normal small intestine and large intestine. This picture shows small intestine inside large intestine. This is a case of intussusception. It presents with crampy abdominal pain with emesis and bloody mucus stool, which is called as current jelly stool. On examination, there will be sausage-like mass. Air contrast enema is both diagnostic and therapeutic for intussusception. Now let us see a case of intussusception. 1-year-old presents with irritability and crampy intermittent abdominal pain with diarrhea. Stools are goiac positive, indicating there is blood in the stools. Physical examination reveals tubular sausage-like mass. Now let us see about meckel diverticulum. It is a slight bulge in small intestine present at birth. It is a vestigial remnant of omphalomesenteric duct, which is also known as vitelline duct or yolk sac. It presents with painless rectal bleeding. This picture shows Meckel's diverticulum. It is diagnosed using technetium pertechnetate scan, which detects ectopic gastric mucosa. There is rule of 2s for Meckel's diverticulum. Males are at 2 times higher risk. It is 2 feet from ileocecal wall. There are 2 types of ectopic mucosa, gastric or pancreatitis. It affects 2% of population and it affects children between 2 months to 2 years of age. Now let us see a case of Meckel's diverticulum. 2-year-old presents with painless rectal bleeding. Radionuclide scan reveals ectopic gastric mucosa proximal to the ileocecal wall. Now let us see about Hirschsprung disease. It is due to failure of ganglionic cell migration. This picture shows normal ganglion cells. In this case, there is no ganglion cells. This will lead to abdominal distension, as you can see in this picture. How does the child with histone disease present to you, there will be delayed passage of meconium. Now let us see what malrotation. It is a congenital anomaly of rotation of the midgut. It will present as bilious MSS in a child less than 1 month of age. It is diagnosed by an upper GI series, which is a barium study. This picture shows abdominal X-ray of a child with malrotation. If you notice, there are prominent loops of gas-filled small bowel. However, no gas is seen in rectum. Now let us see a case of malrotation. A 2-week-old presents with bilious MSS. Upper GI series reveals an abnormally placed cecum and ligament of Treitz. Now let us see about various conditions in pediatric endocrinology. First, let us discuss about insulin dependent diabetes mellitus or type 1 diabetes mellitus. It is due to lack of insulin production by beta cells in pancreas. Clinical features include polyuria, polydipsia, fatigue and abdominal pain. For patients with type 1 diabetes mellitus, we have to do urine screening for microalbuminemia, ophthalmologic examination for retinopathy and lipid profile for hyperlipidemia. Now let us see a case of type 1 diabetes mellitus. 4-year-old presents with new onset weight loss, polyphagia and polyuria. Physical examination reveals dehydration but is otherwise normal. Glucose is 400 mg per deciliter. Now let us see about diabetic ketoacidosis. The clinical features include hyperglycemia, ketoacidosis, dehydration and lethargy. Treatment goals for diabetic ketoacidosis are fluid resuscitation, insulin therapy and electrolyte management. A major complication in treatment of diabetic ketoacidosis is cerebral edema. This is because insulin drives glucose into cells, thus altering osmotic pressure, leading to cerebral edema. Now let us see a case of diabetic ketoacidosis. 8-year-old with a history of insulin dependent diabetes mellitus presents with abdominal pain and nausea and vomiting. Physical examination shows tachycardia. ABG shows acidosis. Urine is positive for ketones. Now let us see about constitutional delay and familial short stature. In constitutional delay, there is normal growth velocity at or below the 5th percentile. There is delay in bone age and puberty is typically delayed. In case of familial short stature, the growth curve falls below the 5th percentile with abnormal growth velocity. There will be normal bone age. If you see in this picture, constitutional delay eventually reaches the mean, whereas familial short stature does not reach the mean. Now let us see about pathologic causes of short stature. Growth hormone deficiency, primary hypothyroidism, Cushing disease, chronic systemic disease, psychosocial deprivation and Turner syndrome. In congenital hypothyroidism, there will be severe mental retardation. Now let us see about congenital adrenal hyperplasia. It is due to 21-hydroxylase deficiency. The clinical features include ambiguous genitalia, hyponatremia and hyperkalemia due to lack of aldosterone and hypoglycemia due to lack of cortisol. It is diagnosed by elevated levels of 17-hydroxyprogesterone. How do you treat a case of congenital adrenal hyperplasia? We have to give glucocorticoids for suppression of androgen production and mineralocorticoids for electrolyte imbalance. Now let us see a case of congenital adrenal hyperplasia. 1-day-old female presents with ambiguous genitalia, which is due to lack of sex steroids. On newborn examination, labs reveal hyponatremia and hyperkalemia due to lack of aldosterone and hypoglycemia due to lack of cortisol. There is also high levels of 17-hydroxyprogesterone, which is diagnostic of congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Now let us see about various hematological conditions. First, let us discuss about sickle cell disease. It is typically found on newborn screen. It may present after 4 months of age when HbF levels begin to decline. Complications include bone and chest pain, dactylitis, priapism or stroke. Now let us see about the treatment of acute symptoms of sickle cell disease. We have to give oxygen, analgesia, antibiotics and exchange transfusion. Now let us see a case of sickle cell disease. 4-month-old presents with pallor, Physical examination reveals splenomegaly and a grade 2 systolic ejection murmur. Hemoglobin electrophoresis shows high HPS concentration. In children less than 2 years of age, there will be splenomegaly due to extramedullary hematopoiesis and congestion. Eventually, there will be autoinfarction of spleen. This grade 2 systolic ejection murmur is also known as anemic murmur. This high hemoglobin S concentration is the diagnostic feature of sickle cell disease on electrophoresis. Now let us see about the complications of sickle cell disease. Acute chest syndrome can lead to infarction and hemolysis of lung tissue. Dactylitis causes painful swelling of the hands and feet. Aplastic crisis is a potentially fatal complication typically induced by parvovirus B19 infection. We must regularly check reticulocyte count in sickle cell patients to diagnose aplastic crisis. Vaso-occlusive episode causes pain, priapism or painful erection, gallbladder disease, chronic renal failure, splenic infarction and avascular necrosis of femoral head. Now let us see about autoinfarction. Sickle cell disease causes microvascular obstruction and leads to fibrosis of the spleen. So these patients will have increased susceptibility of infection with encapsulated organisms like Haemophilus influenzae and Streptococcus pneumonia, which can lead to sepsis. Now let us see some clinical cases of sickle cell disease. 8-year-old with history of sickle cell disease presents with severe abdominal pain precipitated by nausea and vomiting. This indicates vaso-occlusive pain episode. 10-year-old with history of sickle cell disease presents in respiratory distress. The hematocrit is reduced and there is decreased oxygen saturation. This is a case of acute chest syndrome. Now let us see about iron deficiency anemia. It is the most common cause of anemia in pediatric population. There is history of drinking lot of cow's milk or transition to cow's milk before 12 months of age. Now let us see about hereditary spherocytosis. The mode of inheritance is autosomal dominant. There is positive osmotic fragility test. Now let us see about G6PD deficiency. It is due to depletion of NADPH and an inability to replenish reduced glutathione. It is an X-linked recessive disease. It presents with oxidative stress caused by fava beans or drug exposure like dapsone, sulfonamides and antimalarials. Now let us see about thalassemia. It is inherited hemolytic anemia caused by malformation or malfunction of globin subunits of hemoglobin molecule. In Bart's hemoglobin, there is complete absence of all four globin chains. In hemoglobin H disease, there is absence of 3 alpha globin chains. In beta thalassemia major, there is high levels of HbF and in beta thalassemia minor, there is high levels of HbA2. Now let us see about vitamin B12 deficiency. The patient can present with peripheral neuropathy, paresthesias and posterior column spinal degeneration. Now let us see about Fanconi anemia. It is due to defective DNA repair mechanism. It presents with hyperpigmentation and café au lait spots. Now let us see about coagulation disorders. Hemophilia A is an X-linked recessive disease with deficiency in factor 8. Hemophilia B is again an X-linked recessive disease. In this case, there is deficiency in factor 9. Both these cases can present with bleeding leading to hemarthrosis and intramuscular bleeding. This picture shows bleeding into joints or hemarthrosis. Now let us see a case of hemophilia A, 5-year-old male with history of hemarthrosis and subcutaneous bleeding and prolonged PTT, which indicates a defect in intrinsic pathway of coagulation and low factor 8. Now let us see about von Willebrand disease. In this case, the bleeding sites are from mucous membranes, skin and vagina during menstruation. Now let us see about desmopressin acetate. It causes release of factor 8 and von Willebrand factor from endothelial cells. So it can be used in von Willebrand disease and hemophilia A. Now let us see about laboratory diagnosis of hemophilia A, hemophilia B and von Willebrand disease. There will be increase in partial thromboplastin time, normal prothrombin time and normal platelet aggregation. So this indicates a defect in intrinsic pathway of coagulation. Now let us see about asthma. It is reversible airway obstruction with accompanying bronchial hypersensitivity. Now let us see a clinical case of asthma. 8-year-old presents with persistent nighttime coughing. Audible wheezes are heard and mother smokes around 2 packs of cigarette per day. This is a case of asthma. There will be audible wheezes in asthma. I will walk you through this slide with clinical examples. This chart shows how we classify asthma and this chart shows the treatment of asthma. Now let us understand these two charts with clinical scenarios. Patient presents with symptoms 2 days per week. It is classified as mild intermittent asthma. For mild intermittent asthma, the treatment is short acting inhaled beta 2 agonist as needed. Second case, patient presents with symptoms 3 days per week. In this case, it is mild persistent asthma. For mild persistent asthma, we give low dose inhaled corticosteroids. Third case, patient presents with symptoms daily and several times a week at night. This is a case of moderate persistent asthma. The treatment for moderate persistent asthma is low dose inhaled corticosteroids and a long acting beta 2 agonist. Or we can give medium dose inhaled corticosteroids. Next case, patient with symptoms continually during the day and frequently at night. This is classified as severe persistent. In this case, we give high dose inhaled corticosteroids and a long acting beta 2 agonist. Next case, patient presenting to the emergency room with an acute exacerbation. In this case, we have to do airway breathing and circulation. Then we have to give nebulized beta 2 agonist, nebulized anticholinergic, steroid load with or without supplemental oxygen. If severely ill, we have to consider epinephrine subcutaneously, magnesium sulfate or terbutaline. Okay, now let us see about this slide. This shows the components of severity. The various components include symptoms, nighttime awakening, SABA use for symptom control, interference with normal activity and lung function. As discussed earlier, for step 1 we give short acting beta agonist as required. For step 2 we give low dose inhaled corticosteroid. For step 3 we give low dose inhaled corticosteroid plus long acting beta agonist or medium dose inhaled corticosteroid. Step 4 we give medium dose inhaled corticosteroids plus long acting beta agonist. Step 5 we give high dose inhaled corticosteroids plus long acting beta agonist. Step 6 we give high dose inhaled corticosteroids plus long acting beta agonist plus oral systemic steroid. Some important points to remember are, in each step we have to give patient education, environmental control and management of comorbidities. For quick relief for all patients, we can give short acting beta agonist as needed. It is important to remember that increasing use of SABA or use greater than 2 days a week indicates inadequate control and the patient needs to step up the treatment. Okay, before we step up the treatment, we have to first check adherence, inhaler technique and environmental control. We can step down the treatment if asthma is well controlled for at least 3 months. Now let us see about cystic fibrosis. It is caused by a defect in chloride channel on epithelial cells. It is an autosomal recessive disorder. The gene for cystic fibrosis is located on chromosome 7. The pathognomic feature of cystic fibrosis is meconium ileus, that is intestinal obstruction following inspeciation or thickening of meconium. The most common feature of cystic fibrosis is failure to thrive. Now let us see about the respiratory manifestations of cystic fibrosis. Nasal polyps, sinusitis, bacterial pneumonia, digital clubbing, cough and hemoptysis. Now let us see about gastrointestinal manifestations. Pancreatic insufficiency causing malabsorption, diarrhea and failure to thrive, diabetes, rectal prolapse and meconium ileus. Now let us see about hepatobiliary manifestations. Neonatal jaundice, portal hypertension and cirrhosis. Now let us see about reproductive manifestations. there will be impaired fertility in males. Cystic fibrosis is diagnosed by sweat chloride test. Now let us see about the treatment of cystic fibrosis. Inhaled respiratory treatment like bronchodilators, hypotonic saline and mucolytics can be given. Chest physiotherapy, pancreatic enzymes, vitamins and antibiotics as needed can be given for a patient of cystic fibrosis. Now let us see a case of cystic fibrosis. 5-year-old presents with recurrent upper respiratory tract infection and diarrhea. Physical examination shows nasal polyps, failure to thrive and sweat chloride test is greater than 60 millimole per liter. Now let us see various conditions in pediatric oncology. First let us discuss about acute lymphoblastic leukemia or ALL. It is the most common childhood malignancy. It usually presents in white males between 3 to 5 years of age. This picture shows lymphoblasts in bone marrow aspirate seen in a case of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. Now let us see about acute myelogenous leukemia or AML. It can present in African American male of any age. There are various subtypes of AML. The two important subtypes to remember are M3 and M5. There will be disseminated intravascular coagulation in AML M3. It is also known as acute promyelocytic leukemia. There will be CNS involvement and gingival hyperplasia in AML M5. Now let us see about the initial presentation of leukemia. There will be malaise, fever, bruising and weight loss. Now let us see about the typical late presenting signs of leukemia. There will be bone pain and arthralgia. In case of bone marrow failure, there will be petechiae, pallor, ecchymosis and fever. Pallor is due to decreased RBC, fever is due to decreased WBC, petechiae is due to decreased platelets. Now let us see about the treatment of leukemia. Steroids, vincristine, intrathecal methotrexate and asparaginase are the various treatment options for leukemia. Now let us see a case of acute lymphoblastic leukemia. 4-year-old presents with bone pain. This is due to extramedullary hematopoiesis, arthralgia and lethargy. Physical examination reveals pallor, ecchymosis and fever. Labs show anemia and thrombocytopenia. Now let us see about central nervous system tumors. These are the most common solid tumors and the second most common malignancy in childhood. The various pediatric CNS tumors include craniopharyngioma, optic glioma, astrocytoma, brainstem glioma, infratentorial ependymoma, cerebellar astrocytoma, medulloblastoma, pinealoma and supratentorial ependymoma. In children between 1 to 11 years of age, they typically occur in infratentorial parts like cerebellum, midbrain and brainstem, leading to truncal ataxia, coordination or gait disturbances and head tilt due to cranialopalsies. In children older than 11 years of age, they occur in supratentorial part. CNS tumors can present with increased intracranial pressure. The symptoms of raised intracranial pressure include headaches, vomiting and lethargy. The signs of raised intracranial pressure include hydrocephalus, papal edema and Cushing triad, which includes hypertension, bradycardia and Kleinstock's respiration, which are all late findings. Now let us see about non-Hodgkin lymphoma and Hodgkin disease. Non-Hodgkin lymphoma is more common in pediatric patients. It accounts for 60% of pediatric lymphomas. The peak incidence is between ages 7 to 11 years. It presents with compression symptoms as tumor cells proliferate rapidly. Now let us see about Hodgkin disease. It has a bimodal distribution of age. That is, there are two peaks. First peak is between 40 to 35 years of age. Second peak is between 55 to 74 years of age. It is diagnosed by identification of Reed-Sternberg cells in cancer tissue. This picture shows Reed-Sternberg cells. It presents with painless firm lymphadenopathy. Now let us see about neuroblastoma. It is malignancy of primitive neural crystals of adrenal medulla and sympathetic ganglia. It most commonly arises from abdomen. It is diagnosed by elevated urinary catecholamines and pathological identification of tumor tissue. Now let us see about WAGR syndrome. It includes Wilms tumor, which presents as asymptomatic flag mass, aniridia, which is absence of iris, ambiguous genitalia and mental retardation. Now let us see what orthopedic tumors. Ewing sarcoma arises from undifferentiated small round blue cells. It occurs in diaphysis. This picture shows Ewing sarcoma. There is a light eclosion. Treatment is with surgery and radiation therapy. 20% of cases of Ewing sarcoma present with metastasis at diagnosis. Now let us see about osteosarcoma. It occurs in metaphysis. The classical features include sunburst appearance, as you can see in this picture, and Cartman triangle. It is a malignant tumor of mesenchymal cells. It does not respond to radiation. 20% of cases of osteosarcoma present with metastasis at diagnosis. Now let us see a case of osteosarcoma. 12-year-old presents with pain and localized swelling in the distal femur. There is increased alkaline phosphatase and X-ray shows a light eclosion with a sunburst appearance. Now let us see about various conditions in pediatric rheumatology. First, let us discuss about juvenile idiopathic arthritis, or JIA. The clinical features include joint pain, fatigue, rash, lymphadenopathy, and failure to thrive. Positive antinuclear antibody indicates an increased risk of uveitis in patients with JIA. Treatment of JIA is with anti-inflammatory drugs, immunosuppressive therapy, and physical therapy. Now let us see a case of juvenile idiopathic arthritis. 13-year-old presents with joint pain and fevers. Physical examination reveals a salmon colored rash and lymphadenopathy. There is high WBC count and erythrocyte sedimentation rate. Now let us see about dermatomyositis. Clinical features include Gartner papules, violaceous dermatitis, and proximal muscle weakness. This picture shows Gartner papules in a case of dermatomyositis. The serum creatinine kinase will be significantly elevated in case of dermatomyositis. Now let us see about neural tube defects. It is diagnosed by increased maternal serum alpha fetoprotein level. This picture shows a case of neural tube defect. The incidence of neural tube defects can be reduced by folic acid supplementation to pregnant women. Now let us see a case of spina bifida. 8-year-old with history of bowel and bladder dysfunction presents with a tuft of hair in the lower back. There is scoliosis also. This is a case of spina bifida occulta, which is a neural tube defect. Now let us see about absence seizures. It presents in children less than 10 years of age. EEG pattern will show 3 per second spike and wave pattern. This picture shows the EEG pattern in absence seizures. If you notice, this EEG is normal and there is a sudden onset of abnormal EEG. It is generalized, that is, it involves all the leads, and you can notice this spike. This is the spike and this is the wave, spike and wave pattern, and there is 1, 2, 3 per second. That is, there is 3 per second spike and wave pattern in EEG of absence seizures. Now let us see a case of absence seizures. 6-year-old child presents after episodes of daydreaming in class, described as blank stares. EEG reveals the typical 3 per second spike and wave pattern. Now let us see about infantile spasms. These are seizures occurring in children between 2 to 7 months of age. There will be extensor flexor spasms occurring up to 100 times in a day. The EEG pattern is ipsarrhythmia, which is chaotic pattern. This picture shows a normal EEG. This picture shows an absolutely chaotic EEG, which is ipsarrhythmia, which is a classical finding in infantile spasms. Now let us see about various phacomatosis. Phacomatosis are neuro-oculocutaneous syndromes. Neurofibromatosis type 1 is also known as von Recklinghausen disease. It presents with Café Olé spots or hyperpigmented macules, as you can see in this picture. Tuberous sclerosis presents with ash leaf spots or hypopigmented macules, as you can see in this picture. Sturge-Weber disease presents with port vein stains distributed on ophthalmic branch of trigeminal nerve, as you can see in this two pictures. Now let us see about vasculitides. Vasculitides are a group of autoimmune diseases with vasculitis. These include regular granulomatosis and hemochromatin purpura. Regular granulomatosis presents with positive C ANCA. There is recurrent upper and lower respiratory tract infections. Saddle nose is a feature of Wegener granulomatosis. It is due to granulomatosis and polyangiitis causing nose damage. How do you treat a case of Wegener granulomatosis? Corticosteroids and cyclophosphamide are the treatment options for Wegener granulomatosis. We have discussed about hemochromatin purpura in earlier slides. It presents with palpable purpura, abdominal pain and hematuria. Now let us see about Kawasaki disease. In this case, there will be mucous membrane changes like fissured lips and strawberry tongue. There will be hands and extremity changes like erythema, desquamation and edema. There will be eye changes like conjunctivitis with limbic sparing. There will be cervical lymphadenopathy. The size will be at least 1.5 cm. There will be rash in groin area, which will be polymorphous. There will be fever, that is, there will be high temperature for at least 5 days. Treatment of Kawasaki disease is with intravenous immunoglobulin and aspirin. An important complication of Kawasaki disease is coronary artery aneurysm. Now let us see a case of Kawasaki disease. 5-year-old presents with 60 HT of high fevers. Physical examination reveals conjunctivitis with limbic sparing, adenitis, strawberry tongue and fissured lips. Platelet count is high and hematocrit is low. This slide shows the various clinical manifestations of Kawasaki disease. This picture shows bilateral non-exudative conjunctival injection with perilimbal sparing. This picture shows strawberry tongue and bright red swollen lips with vertical cracking and bleeding. This picture shows erythematous rash involving the perineum. This picture shows erythema of palms. It is accompanied by painful brawny edema of dorsum of hands. This picture shows erythema of soles and swelling of dorsum of feet. This picture shows desquamation in fingers. This picture shows erythema and induration at the site of previous vaccination with BCG. This picture shows perianal erythematous desquamation. These are the various clinical manifestations of Kawasaki disease. Now let us see about leukocoria. Leukocoria is lack of a red reflex. There will be white reflex as you can see in this picture. The various differential diagnosis for leukocoria include retinoblastoma, retinopathy of prematurity and congenital cataracts. Now let us see about an important pediatric psychiatric condition. 7-year-old presents with a 1-year history of leaving seat during class, blurting out answers and interrupting at home. Physical examination and labs are normal. This is a classical case of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder or ADHD. Now let us see about some important orthopedic conditions. First, let us see about developmental hip dysplasia. The screening test for developmental hip dysplasia include Barlow test and Ortolani maneuver. In Barlow test, we do posterior superior dislocation of the hip with positive pressure. That is, we make the baby lie in supine position. We flex the hip and apply posterior pressure on the femur. If the hip is dislocatable, it will dislocate and Barlow test will be positive. In Ortolani maneuver, we will hear a click on hip abduction. That is, it is a technique to relocate the dislocated hip. In Ortolani test, again you make the child lie supine and you abduct the hip and you give anterior pressure on the femur to relocate the hip. If the hip is relocated, you will hear a click and Ortolani maneuver is positive. These two are used to diagnose developmental hip dysplasia. Now let us see a clinical case of developmental hip dysplasia. 1-week-old infant presents with positive hip click and dislocation of the hip with posterior pressure on routine newborn examination. Now let us see about slipped capital femoral epiphysis. It usually presents in obese adolescent male with referred pain to the knee. It is diagnosed using frog leg lateral view, which demonstrates epiphyseal displacement as you can see in this picture. Now let us see a case of slipped capital femoral epiphysis. 13-year-old obese male presents with a painful limb. Frog leg lateral x-ray shows epiphyseal displacement. Now let us see about leg calve pertussis disease. It presents as painless limb in a 5-year-old child caused by avascular necrosis of the femoral head. It is basically idiopathic avascular necrosis of femoral head in children. And let us see about Osgood-Schlatter disease. Let us see a case, 12-year-old with tibial tuberosity point tenderness. This is a case of Osgood-Schlatter disease, which is basically apophysitis of the tibial tubercle resulting from repeated powerful contractions of the quadriceps. This picture shows apophysitis of tibial tubercle, which is also called as Osgood-Schlatter disease. Now let us see about osteomyelitis. The most common cause of osteomyelitis is Staphylococcus aureus. In case of sickle cell disease, the most common organism is Salmonella. In case of puncture wounds through the sole of the foot, it is usually caused by Pseudomonas aeruginosa. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comment section. For more such videos, please check out my playlists. If you like my videos, kindly subscribe. Your subscription will encourage me to make more videos.